You're listening to Right On by Final Draft. I'm your host, Pete D'Alessandro, product manager here at Final Draft. This is normally the podcast where we hear from screenwriters, and we will today. But we'll be talking about our guest's career in directing, especially in music videos and other formats. She's done videos for artists like Katy Perry, Miguel, Alicia Cara. Her work has over a billion views on YouTube. She's also created content for Disney, Spotify, Coke, and lots more. Her show Witness Worldwide was named one of Time Magazine's top 10 TV shows of 2017. And as a special treat, she's provided us with a music video treatment she's done. Go ahead and download that from finaldraft.com when you're done listening to this podcast. I'd like to welcome to the podcast, Aya Tanimura. Aya, thanks so much for joining us.
Hi, thank you so much for having me.
Very excited to have you on. I mean, you're an old friend, so that's always a treat for me, but just going back over your website, your reel, all the stuff you've done, it's just, oh yeah, right, she's been busy. I mean, really busy for a long time.
Well, it's nice to hear that, because I think when you're in the machine and you're chugging along, it can also sometimes feel a little bit like quicksand pace. because obviously I think you always want your career to be moving along a little faster than it is. So I think you sometimes forget how far you have come. So thank you for reminding me.
Thanks for reminding us. Now we all feel lazy. Yeah. So what I'd like to start off with is just sort of how you got into storytelling. You know, what led you to, how old were you when you decided this was going to be the path for you?
Yeah, well, you know, I kind of fell into it due to the fact that I had a very bizarre upbringing with hippie parents who didn't allow me to have any sort of access to kind of digital or even film content. So I had no TV, never went to the movies. I kind of lived in a world of wooden toys and imagination. And so we had no choice but to kind of, we meaning my brother, sister, and I had no choice but to kind of become storytellers for each other. Which, you know, when you're younger, it's kind of just playing make-believe. But then we got access to an 8mm camera, and thus we started making films to watch because we had nothing better to do. So
your parents cutting you off from that. Yeah, right. They cut you off from that, and your career is the direct reaction to that.
Well, it's hilarious because, yeah, my brother's now a VFX guy. I am a director, and my sister works at Google.
So digits are in your life.
Exactly. Yeah, we are all doing a lot of screen time now to make up for all those lost years.
So what about college? How did you wound up going to film school?
Yes. So I think just because filmmaking was so much of my upbringing, I never really thought I would do anything else. And so when college came around, I was in Switzerland for high school, and I pretty much just looked up schools that would let me kind of do film, photography, and visual arts, so painting, and or as my dad said, triple majoring in waitressing. and I found this school in upstate New York that had this program, which is Ithaca College's Bachelor of Fine Arts. And so I went there and I studied film. And then upon graduating, moved out to LA with no connections whatsoever and did what most, you know, normal people do, which is go on Craigslist. Right. And I found my first job, which just so happened to not be in the porn industry, by some small miracle. Judd Apatow's producer Clayton Townsend was looking for an assistant, and he apparently was sick of seeing the same people, so he posted that on Craigslist, and that's kind of was my foray into the business. I was assisting.
Wow. And then what wound up happening there? What kind of job was it? What did you wind up experiencing, learning?
So, you know, I was extremely lucky because Clayton Townsend is a line producer. So I kind of had access to every single department and access to Judd and the writers and the cast. So I kind of observed everything from start to finish in terms of the making of Funny People. And then right after Funny People, I moved on to Inception with Chris Nolan. Where I was assisting Chris Brigham, who was the line producer on that, and again had access to every department and everything, and kind of saw the process from start to finish of that movie, which couldn't be more polar opposite to Funny People. But it was the most amazing education, you know, in filmmaking and different styles. And I think my biggest takeaway from both those experiences was that there are no rules, right? So I think coming from a directing background, if you haven't been exposed to anything, you might think, or as naively as I did, oh, there must be a way to direct. But it was very liberating to see Judd work and then to see Chris work and realize that, oh, you make your own rules and how you're going to tell your story. And that has been very helpful for me throughout my short-lived career so far.
It always reminds me of, there's that element of, you know, a lot of people tell you when you first start working in Hollywood, you have to pay your dues.
And oh, yeah.
The truth of it is that there's no one collecting those dues.
Right.
So you can just pay them all day long and you won't get anywhere. And that sounds like the same sort of realization. Those rules don't really exist, and following them or breaking them.
Right. Right. Yeah. I mean, this business is so weird. There's no do A and you'll end up in B and then you can move to C, you know.
Right. Right.
So I think everyone's just making their own rules, which is a double-edged sword, really, isn't it? Because it's very liberating, but it's also extremely frustrating. Because you can be a brilliant, brilliant storyteller, and no one could ever see your work or hear your work or have your work ever made. But you could also be extremely mediocre and be extremely successful in this business.
Yeah.
So,
yes,
as we know.
That is the sad and happy of it.
Yeah, exactly. It's the American dream.
So you learn a lot about everything kind of hanging out with a line producer. What made you look at the path you're looking at now? I mean, music videos and a lot of, I don't know if you want to call it short form content, but whatever it is, you would put all that stuff under one umbrella. Whatever that word is, what made you take this path?
Well, it wasn't something I set out to do, to be honest. You know, I don't come from a wealthy family. So when I moved out here, I didn't have the luxury of not working. Mm-hmm. So when between Funny People, was it between Funny People and Inception? I can't even remember what the timeline was, but there was a period of time where I was broke, and my friend was working for Russell Brand at the time, who had just gotten together with Katy Perry and bought a house. And I am type A anal retentive, and my friend knew I was broke, and he said, "Hey, listen, I can hook you up with 2 weeks of organizing Katy Perry's closet." And wow. I said, "Great, you know, I'll take it." And through that, you know, organizing of cupcake bras, I met KG, and she just so happened to be coming out with a new album. This was, I think, two or three album cycles ago now. And, you know, she was like, "What do you do?" And I said, "Well, you know, I'm organizing your bras, but, you know, the long-term game I'm playing is directing." And she asked to see some of my stuff, and she liked it, and she gave me a chance. She said, "Would you like to shoot the lyric videos for my new album?" And I said, "Sure." And I ran home that night, and I was like, "What the fuck is a lyric video?" And I looked it up, and I was like, "Oh, God." Because at the time, it was literally animated lyrics flashing on a screen. I was like, first of all, I don't know how to animate. Second of all, this is the most boring shit I've ever seen in my entire life. So, you know, the label gave me no money. I think it was $500 or something for the first lyric video, because, you know, I think they were expecting some flashy animation.
So wait, but are you saying $500 for the budget or $500 for you?
Oh, no, $500 period. Like, that's it. There was no money making in this.
Yes.
No, but it was, you know, an opportunity. And it was more out of necessity than creativity. I was like, well, I don't know how to animate, so how am I going to get these lyrics on the screen? So then I kind of started making these lyric videos that were done practically with the lyrics incorporated into, you know, live footage. And people were like, ah, this is so creative and a genius concept. And it kind of just took off. And then I became, you know, the go-to lyric video girl and got signed to Ridley Scott's agency for music videos.
Wow.
And then all of a sudden I was on this music video trajectory. And that was, I guess, 3 years ago now.
Wow.
And so, yeah. And then so music videos then led to commercials. And now commercials are starting to lead to, you know, scripted content. And I'm kind of climbing this ladder. It seems like super slow. Right. Like, I wish I could go a little faster. But yeah, that's kind of how it all happened.
That's awesome. So there you are. You're starting to develop sort of, I don't know if you want to call it a routine. I don't know if that's fair in directing music videos. Is that a bad word?
You know, freelance in this business, there's nothing routine about it. Some months you're like, oh, okay, so I'm going to be homeless. And then other months you're like, oh my God, I'm so rich. There's just kind of, yeah. But I am very ingrained now in the music video business that I feel like I know all the key players and I'm comfortable in this world.
I'd love to hear more about that. You said key players. I wouldn't even really know what that would mean. What is that? I'm not looking for individual names, but like, what does that mean?
So the way the music video business works is basically there's the label, who are the people, you know, paying for these videos. And then the label, if it's a big label, usually has a commissioner at the label who is the person that will go out to directors to have them write on music videos. And so oftentimes what you'll get is a commissioner will reach out to you and they'll say, hey, listen, the budget is X amount of dollars. You know, this is the song, this is the artist. And then they'll send you a brief. And sometimes the brief will be, go for it. And there are no parameters. Sometimes it's super specific and they'll say, you know, must have a unicorn flying on a zebra on top of a, you know, John Deere tractor, and you're like, great. And then you go ahead and you put together a treatment and hope for the best. Usually I would say on average you're bidding against 10 to 15 other directors, so it's pretty cutthroat. Mm-hmm. And you don't get paid for your treatments, so
that's all spec work.
It's all spec work. And the most heartbreaking part of it too is, I mean, this hasn't happened to me lately, but when I was first starting out, I would write these treatments and I wouldn't get booked. They'd be like, oh, great concept, but you know, you just don't have enough stuff on your reel for us to hire you.
Wow.
And then the video would come out and it would be your concept.
Ooh.
And you know, that can happen sometimes with, you know, a bunch of directors writing, and a concept could be doubled up. It's possible, but my concepts tend to be pretty bizarre. Mm. So the likelihood of it being, you know, a coincidence that someone else happened to write the same thing is very, very slim. So that was really heartbreaking when stuff like that would happen. But
yeah.
But yeah, so that's the business. It crushes your soul.
And occasionally feeds you.
Yeah, and occasionally feeds you. But, you know, it's tough being a music video director because you are the one coming up with the concept. And then when you go to execute, you know, there's never enough money. But then also when you're shooting and along the process, you have a label person that's giving you their input and their needs and wants. And then you have the artist with their input and their needs and wants. And then the management. And then, you know, inevitably the artist's cousins aunt happens to be on set that day and she has an opinion and you have to pay attention to that. And if you're not really strong in what it is that you're trying to accomplish, it's very easy to see your concept get diluted very quickly. along the way.
I would think you'd have to really defend from a lot of other people's views and opinions trying to come in and steer your project in the wrong way.
Yeah, I mean, it's a really fine balancing act, and sometimes it's just out of your control, you know? But it's interesting now, having been in the business for a few years, watching videos, like the shittiest music video can come out, and I'm like, you know what? Good for them. They made it. Because I'm like, who knows what happened on that shoot? You know, who knows what that concept was on paper before it came out, you know, the way it did come out. So I'm like, you know what, because that's another thing about the music video business that people don't know is I would say a solid 40% of videos that are made never come out.
Wow. 40%.
Yeah. It's pretty high, the amount of videos that get canned, as they say, in the business.
So someone pays for it, and then that money just goes away. Yep.
Goes away.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So I actually always joke with other music video directors that there should be like a secret underground society where we can show these videos that never came out. Because a friend of mine showed me this Nine Inch Nails music video that got canned, and it's so good. And they spent 4.5 months shooting this thing. And I'm like, oh my God, it's so heartbreaking that you can literally never show this.
Wow. That sounds like a wonderful underground film festival one day.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Because I'm sure there's many more brilliant music videos out there that none of us even know exist.
Wow. Well, let's talk about some of the treatments. I mean, I'd like to get into an example, but is a treatment for one of these en route to a pitch, or do you pitch and then decide you're going to do the treatment?
No, your pitch is your treatment. So you're never pitching in person. You just kind of send this, document off into outer space, and 99% of the time you just never hear back, and you're like, oh, and then the video comes out and you're like, oh, I guess I didn't book that job. and then other times you hear back right away. Other times you have to do 27 revisions on it and then you book the job, and sometimes you do 27 revisions and you don't book the job. Wow. But yeah, I mean, it's tough to put a treatment together, you know, because you write the copy, and then you have to pull all your reference images, and then you have to put it all together. Right. So, yeah. And that's once you've come up with the concept, which, you know, it doesn't always happen when you listen to the song for, you know, the first 5 minutes. But for me, putting a pitch together is usually a 2 to 3 day process, a treatment. Yeah.
So that's not free. I mean, that costs you some real time, and you do 10 or 20 of those to get your next job.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. That could be really hard.
It's really, really tough. And actually, the Daniels, who are a directing duo, they did Swiss Army Man, the feature film, Swiss Army Man.
Swiss Army Man, right.
Yeah, but those guys come from music videos and commercials as well. And actually, Daniel Kwan of the Daniels is trying to unionize music videos right now, so that we have a little bit of protection. Because the other thing, too, is you don't get any credit. The director is not credited on music videos, which is like just a basic thing you would think they would do.
Yes.
But you really have to search to find out who directed what, and oftentimes you can't even find it. But also, to just get compensated for putting these pictures together.
Right. I mean, there's no such thing as a residual for a music video for a director.
And no, and that's the other thing, too, is to try and get back end points for these videos that get, you know, millions of views on YouTube, and the artist and the label makes millions of dollars in advertising, but the director will never see any of that money.
Right, right. That would be interesting to see what that unionization looked like. We followed a little bit of that as the script coordinators joined IATSE early this year.
Right.
So we'll follow up on that.
Yeah. If you look up Daniel Kwan on Twitter, he's updating all the information kind of in real time. So
that's great.
Yeah.
All right. Well, let's get back to, I don't know if you can share an example, But I would love to hear, you know, if there's something recent that we could see that you could walk us through, you know, what the treatment looked like. You know, I don't even know how long some document like that would be, but where you're pulling those reference images from. What does that all look like? How do we know if we've never seen one?
Right. I mean, if you have a website, I would be happy to send you whatever it is I'm about to talk about so people can look at it if they
Thanks.
Want.
Thanks. That would be wonderful.
But I guess an example would be I just shot this music video that came out with Aloi, who's the voice of Moana from the Disney animated movie. And Disney is doing this campaign called Dream Big Princess, where they're trying to empower little girls and kind of rebrand the princess franchise to be more about ability and brains rather than, you know, dresses and pretty stuff. I'm being very, oh my God, I've lost my words. I'm really not being very eloquent right now. I apologize. But so for that video, they came to me, they single bid me, which in the music video business means I'm not having to compete against other directors for the job. And the pitch process with that was, here's the song, here's the artist that's singing, you know, here's the budget. We would love to know, how you would envision this music video, given that we want to infuse it with as many of the princesses as possible, so footage, you know, to be incorporated into the video, knowing that, you know, it's supposed to be empowering young females. So I tend to start my idea process off, if something doesn't come right away, with just looking at art references. I also have a folder on my computer that just says inspiration, where anytime I see something quirky or interesting, I kind of just dump it in that folder to spark ideas. And for that particular concept, I based it on this artist whose name I am now forgetting because I'm losing my mind. But it'll come to me and I'll just blurt it out later. But she lives in a one-bedroom apartment in Manhattan, and I think it's 200 square feet. But she changes her one-room apartment into these, like, magical dreamlike spaces.
Wow.
So, you know, she'll paint the whole space. So one's like a yellow space that's full of paper clips that are the size of her, they're just like a pile of paper clips.
Wow.
And then another one is she's painted the whole room blue, and she's in these like massive large scale paper boats that are on this like rough sea that she's made out of construction paper. But yeah, so that was kind of like my starting off point. And I was like, oh, what if we kind of took the essence of some of these princesses' worlds within the movie and made them really kind of arts and craftsy and artistic, and based on the one like can-do element that the princess had. So we did Brave, we did Belle from Beauty and the Beast, we did Ariel, the Little Mermaid, and we did Tiana. And if you look at the music video, Aloi goes through each of these rooms, and she has to kind of like physically get through them to get to the next, on this little bit of an adventure. And each room has a color theme, that matches the princess. And then the footage is incorporated kind of organically as opposed to having to cut to it. I don't even remember what the question was at this point. Oh, putting the treatment together.
Yeah, yeah.
So, you know, once I kind of came up with how I was going to incorporate the footage and what the world was going to look like, then you just, you know, sit for 8 hours straight until you can't feel your butt anymore and pull as many images off the internet. And then you eat lots of snacks and you sit back down and you just kind of start putting it all together. Which, you know, once you start putting it together, you realize all the images you pulled aren't quite right. And then you go back and pull more images
What are you looking for in those images? Well, how do you know? I mean, how would you know what's right and what's wrong? How do you feel that out?
Well, I think that's the director in you, right? So there is no right and wrong. Mm-hmm. It's just kind of, you want it to feel as close to what you have in your brain. Because that's the other thing too, is once you put an image into a treatment, people take it very literally. So, you know, sometimes when I first started out making treatments, I'd put images in and I'd be like, oh, this is the image, but I only want this image to be referenced for lighting, not for the person in it, not for what the person's wearing in it, you know. But now I realize that you can't do that. Like, you need to find an image where the person is right, what they're wearing is right, what the lighting is right, because, you know, someone's going to have an opinion on that and be wow. like, oh, yeah. So it's really time consuming
wow.
to find those exact images. And, you know, treatments that I think that treatment is 25 pages long. So they're not wow. short.
I mean, yeah. that's some bulk of, I think would be some images in there, but it's still long.
Yeah. 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 Yeah.
Wow.
So, yeah, that's what I do most days is sit on my couch in my pajamas, Googling the perfect image.
Right. I'm sure from any outsider's perspective, it looks like you're absolutely not working.
Right. Right, right, right. But it's a lot of work. And you know what's interesting is it's infinitely more difficult to put a treatment together when you're working and creating something for a person of color, because all of a sudden the images available to you get halved. Wow. Halved if it's an African American person, and then almost impossible. I just put a treatment together for a Japanese band, and I ended up having to put like a caution at the beginning saying, I understand a lot of these pictures do not have Japanese people in them, but that's because there are simply no images for me to source that would fit into this treatment with Japanese people in them. So wow. please ignore the race and just look at the kind of vibe.
Wow. That, yeah. that particular music video would be working to solve part of that problem, I guess, on one small level.
Yeah. 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 No, absolutely. But it is a little bit depressing.
Yeah, for sure. That's gotta be tough.
Yeah.
Well, let's move on to, I mean, I wanted to talk more about some of the specific videos and some of the kind of specific process of storytelling, because a lot of your videos, they really do tell a story. So what does that mean to you? How do you approach that? Do you ever look at, I mean, maybe if you have a recent example of something you've done, like what are you trying to achieve on any sort of emotional level, storytelling level?
Right. Well, I think because my background coming into music videos was never music video based. It was always kind of narrative storytelling based. Mm-hmm. That my videos, I kind of approach more like short films, which, it, to be honest, has not been particularly helpful in the business, because people love a strobe, people love a neon light, and it's just not my thing. And not because I don't appreciate it, but just because my mind doesn't think that way. So, you know, I think my approach in creating a music video is I do want to, you know, hit story beats. I want to have a beginning. I want to have a middle. I want to have an end. I want to have, you know, kind of a character arc and a story trajectory. And I don't want it to just be images cut together really quick, which yeah. is not a bad thing. But it's just not my thing. So yeah, when I get a song, I listen to it obviously, and I always ask for a lyric sheet, because normally in a song they're telling a story, right? So you kind of take the lyric sheet as your script, or at least the basis of your script, and then kind of envision how you would tell scripted story.
Right. So you kind of have to, I don't want to say mirror, but you follow that, and that sort of seems to form a spine, a structure of sorts.
Right. 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 That's your blueprint for what you're going to build upon. And then obviously your cast is pretty much already cast because the artist is going to be your lead. and then, yeah, you kind of just, you build from there. So I think what's nice about music videos, especially if you look back, not so much anymore, actually, sadly, but like if you look back to the origin of music videos in the early 90s, early 2000s with the Spike Lees and the Michelle Gondrys, is that although you're telling a story, there's also no rules. So you can break there are no rules in film and TV either, but I feel like you have a lot more people to convince that there are no rules. Whereas in music videos, it's like, oh, you're going to break fourth wall probably anyhow, because the artist at some point is probably going to be singing to camera. But you can do weird camera moves and weird color grades and weird things to kind of help tell your story that I feel like most people would push back against if you were going to go pitch it to a studio or a network.
Right.
So that's really nice. And freeing. It's kind of like experimental filmmaking.
Right. Music videos are sort of that Wild West where you do get to experiment a lot more than almost any other format, I think.
Yeah, I would say so. I mean, not as much now as they used to, because I think people are afraid to, because the budgets have gotten so low that they definitely want something that's going to hit. So a lot of the time nowadays, you'll get a brief and it was like, oh, we really love, you know, Ariana Grande's latest video. And then the next 6 months, everyone's video is going to look like a poor man's version of whatever Ariana Grande came out with.
Wow.
And, you know, people are scared to go a little different or weird, which is a bummer, because I've got this great pitch I keep sending out and no one wants to do it, about a giant meatball. But but someday someone will make my giant meatball music video and it'll be glorious. But for now, you know, everyone wants neon lights and strobing. But that being said, you know, I still think there's more wiggle room in music videos.
Sure. Yes. I would. I mean, that definitely, as you say, that strikes me as something I should have known.
Everyone's video should look like Ariana Grande's.
Yes, that too. That too. Yes. Just that landscape. That's great.
Right.
So what are some of the big challenges that you've faced, overcome, either in the treatment for one of these or just in shooting? What have been some of the big hurdles that you've had to jump over, either on set or whenever?
I think the biggest hurdle, and I'm sure everyone faces this, is always trying to kind of get to that next level, right? And having to find someone that will take a risk on you. I know this sounds very practical and not perhaps that interesting, but being patient enough and believing enough in yourself to know that it'll happen eventually. But it's oh my gosh, I'm rambling. I don't remember what the question was, what the biggest hurdle is. I think, yeah, the biggest hurdle is finding people to believe in you when you may, in your career, have not reached the point where people have seen that you're capable of doing more than what you're currently doing, right? So, right. Like, each next step you want to make, like, the first commercial you shoot, someone has to take a chance on you. The first episodic TV, you know, you do, someone has to take a chance on you. And I think those are the biggest hurdles, because it's really frustrating knowing you have the skill set and you're just waiting on that one person to be like, okay, I'm gonna take a chance on you.
Right,
don't fuck it up.
Right, that if not financial, but that social angel investor.
Yeah. It totally is that. Someone has to put their, like, you know, I was lucky Katie put her neck out for me originally with those. I mean, I guess she didn't put her neck out that much. It was $500. Right. They could have canned it and easily had something come out in time. So maybe it wasn't that much of a risk, but she gave me an opportunity, you know, which kind of got the ball rolling. And again, there's a commissioner over at Disney called Craig Cox, who gave me my first music video. And I remember right before we started rolling that day, he just came over and he whispered in my ear. He was like, "Don't fuck it up." And I was like, "Oh God, oh God, oh God." Because he really, you know, he fought for me to do that video. And yeah. If he didn't, who knows where I'd be right now.
Wow.
I think the hurdles that you have no control over are the most horrible, frustrating ones. And it's those people that need to believe in you.
Right. And getting those people to, to take that leap.
Yeah, exactly. Which has nothing to do with storytelling. I apologize.
It certainly does. It really does, because we all, in storytelling, we all have to get people to believe in that. And that's the wonderful part about storytelling, is when you really get to actually do the telling, you're making them believe.
Right. Yeah. I need to make them believe a little better, I guess. I got to work on my storytelling.
I think as the last couple of years have shown, you've obviously made a lot of people believe very often in you.
I guess I'm getting there.
Right. and certainly modest about it. So. Well, the other thing I'd like to close with is I'd like to ask, that piece of advice, if you had to do it over again, what would you tell yourself? Would there be a shortcut for you, knowing what you know now?
Oof. See, I don't think there is a shortcut, because there's no path. There's no one path to take in order to even figure out a shortcut. So sadly, no shortcut.
Hmm.
But I think if I could go back in time and do it over again, I would tell wee little Aya to have a little more confidence and believe in myself, because I didn't take the leap in calling myself a director for years, because I just didn't believe that I was, because I wasn't making enough money to sustain myself from directing.
Yeah.
But you kind of have to just cut the cord and say, I'm a director and this is what I do, and I'm poor as fuck, but this is me, and scream it, right. And believe it, because no one else is going to do it unless you do. And I wish I had have kind of had that confidence earlier.
Right. Well, I hope you've certainly earned it now.
I scream it every morning. I'm a director. I'm just
kidding. It's a good way to wake up.
Yeah, maybe not so much for my neighbors, no, but I don't actually wake up and scream I'm a director.
Well, if you did, it would be a wonderful way to leave off the podcast, but in the meantime.
True. In the meantime.
Aya Tanimura, thank you so much for joining us.
Thank you so much for having me.
And don't forget to go to finaldraft.com to check out Aya Tanimura's PDF treatment of Dream Big, Princess. Thank you out there for listening to us. Thank you for leaving all those ratings and reviews. That really helps other people find the podcast and lets us know just how good a job we're doing. So thank you for that. Until next time, I'm Pete D'Alessandro. Right on.